Media.
Welcome to the Holistic Wealth Podcast. I'm your host, Keisha Blair, wife, mother of three, author of Holistic Wealth, and founder of the Institute on Holistic Wealth. The show will showcase various experts in the key pillars of holistic wealth. Each week, we deliver the best information on how to become holistically wealthy and live your best life. Welcome to the Holistic Wealth Podcast, and I'm your host, Keisha Blair, and today we have a very special guest with us. Today we have Damali Peterman, and Damali is the founder and CEO and chief conflict resolver of Breakthrough ADR. Damali, welcome to the show. We're so happy to have you.
Hi, Keisha. It's a pleasure to be here with you today.
Okay, perfect. And so your entrepreneurial journey is of great interest to us, and so I just wanted to start off with that. And just to ask you about how you started, your reason for launching Breakthrough ADR. Can you tell us a bit more about that?
Certainly, it'd be my pleasure. So I guess my journey informally started with conflict resolution when I was a child. I'm the oldest of seven children. And so wow. I like to tell people that I started resolving conflict around the age of three when my first sibling was born. And that sort of led me down a path of informal advocacy. And then later, I ended up going to graduate school to study international policy studies with a focus on conflict resolution. I later went to law school. And, you know, between grad school and law school, I studied in The Hague in the Netherlands, which is pretty well known for kind of being the epicenter of conflict resolution theory and ideology. Mm-hmm. And so that sort of led me down the path of post-law school, working in big law for a pretty well-known international law firm for several years, and then going in-house to an even larger corporation for a few years. And then I started my first company, which will probably come as no surprise, was a law firm, and it still exists. Kind of the foundation for Breakthrough ADR was a program under the law firm. I wanted it to kind of have its own life, but because most people in New York knew me as an attorney, a lot of the work that came to me initially was, you know, similar to what I was doing already. So a lot of negotiations and contract revisions. Whereas when I launched my law firm, I really just wanted to save the world. I really wanted to focus on conflict resolution, conflict dynamics, conflict de-escalation. And there came a point in time when I was able to give Breakthrough more than just a program, because it started to resonate more as people kind of saw the need for what I was doing. And so I gave it its own life and started it I launched it as its own company in 2019. And that sort of led us to where we are today.
Yeah, no, for sure. And, you know, as you're speaking, like, I can't help thinking, Damali, about the situation that we saw unfold with what happened with the rioters that stormed the Capitol. And as you're talking about de-escalation, it came to me, because it's still all over the news, still very topical. And I'm wondering if you have thoughts on that in terms of the de-escalation approaches and kind of what could have been done better in that situation, because we've all looked on the world stunned. And so, given your expertise, did you have any thoughts when you saw that?
I did, Keisha, especially because my master's thesis focused on how to use lessons learned throughout the world to de-escalate insurrections, essentially. Wow. So I had a lot of thoughts as I watched it unfold, especially because I'm a native Washingtonian. I'm from Washington, D.C. Mm-hmm. I grew up not that far from the Capitol. And so I had a variety of feelings, both related to my, you know, professional pursuits, and then of course personally, as far as what could have been done to sort of have a different path for the insurrection. I think one thing to think about is sort of the folks who you know, stormed the Capitol. Where were they mentally? What options did they see themselves having? How else could that energy have been channeled into a different outcome? And I feel like sometimes when people feel as though they don't have any alternatives or other options, That's when you see things that happen. You know, of course, some of that was also fueled by perspectives and beliefs and, you know, perhaps some perceived commands from the top. And so I kind of feel like in that situation, it was just a recipe for disaster. Yeah. It's everything that you can think of that could have gone wrong, that did go wrong, ending in, you know, unnecessary deaths as well. So it was something that's kind of a textbook example of what could go wrong when you have a lot of pent up negative energy that has nowhere to go.
And I'm sure, you know, with the advent of social media and organizing, you know, and the way that people can come together and organize online, which is just unprecedented, right? I mean, from a conflict resolution standpoint, because I remember when I did an executive leadership program at Harvard, and it was in leading change and organizing. And, you know, just thinking about, you know, how they were able to kind of come together online and get the type of organization to launch something like that. I mean, it's just unbelievable. I don't know if, you know, you had covered that in your thesis back then, but I'm sure from your standpoint, you know, the way people are able to come together to launch these massive insurrections now, from a conflict resolution standpoint, like when you saw this, is this like one of the major challenges in the field now with the advent of these online platforms and how people are able to organize?
Yeah, you know, it's an interesting question, Keisha. Organizing online can have a positive outcome too, right? So I think that the question is, you know, when organizing goes wrong, you know, what can be done to prevent that? And you've heard me say that I'm an attorney. Of course, I think that some of this can be found in sort of the basis of freedom of speech, right? But then that doesn't mean you can say and do anything that you want without any consequences, right? Like we've seen that happen with social media. People asserting their right to free speech and then getting fired for saying something that, you know, does not bode well with their company's mission, vision, or public persona. And so there are consequences to freedom of speech. With respect to organizing, I think that it's amazing what can be done with organizing. There, even before social media, there were a lot of grassroots movements for a variety of different topics, typically when a particular group is feeling repressed or oppressed or suppressed, right? And so even before there was email, right? So, I mean, technology continues to advance and then people learn how to use it to accomplish the goals they want to accomplish. But with respect to the insurrection and how things were, people were mobilized, I mean, one, that gives you a good sense of the scope of age, right? Because clearly there are a lot of people who are fall outside of that scope who couldn't have been as actively involved because maybe they aren't as technologically savvy, right? So then too, that also kind of shows you how easy it is to communicate, right? Before, like when I was younger, you know, you had to pay for long distance services to call across the border, right? To Maryland or to Virginia. And now everything is seamless. All you need essentially is a smartphone and internet access. And, you know, you can communicate with people across the country to plan something like this. I think that, you know, you mentioned the course at Harvard for leadership that you took. I've taken several courses, including a negotiations mastery course at Harvard Business School. And what I'm bringing that up to say is that negotiations, I mean, is really at the epicenter of a lot of conflict, is when people feel as if they don't have any leverage in a particular situation, when negotiations go wrong and things go awry. But the way that I perceived a lot of the people who I watched on TV, like most people did, storm the Capitol, was they didn't like the result. Right. Of particular, it's called a negotiation outcome elections. I mean, you know, they didn't like the result and they wanted to show that. But I think with conflict, the way that conflict works is it can really escalate very quickly, Keisha. Like, you know, a frown begets a frown, begets a scowl, begets a scowl, begets a, you know, yelling, then fighting. I mean, we've seen this unfold, you know, with people who were waiting online to buy something. And next thing you know, there's a conflict escalating. You've seen it happen on TV where there's a, something that's a seemingly small issue that then results in a death, right? And so conflict is something that you know, I kind of want to take it away from the insurrection and just think about how it shows up in daily lives mm-hmm. and how many times people can kind of sit there and be in a situation where they wonder how they got there because things happened so quickly
yeah.
and they didn't realize that they were reacting and each reaction had a counter reaction and then communications break down or even worse
yeah.
results can occur.
Yeah, absolutely. As you're speaking, I'm thinking about your field and it's so topical right now, right? With everything going on and it extends beyond, you know, conflict. And you mentioned negotiation, which is a critical tool in our toolbox. And you're right. You know, some of us haven't developed that skill as much as we should to arrive at the outcomes we want. And so I wanted to ask you about some of the hurdles you faced along the way in your field with not only your business, but your career in general, because it's, you know, it's Black History Month too. And several guests on the program have highlighted some of their struggles and some of their barriers that they faced. And so I just wanted to ask you about your experience in terms of the hurdles that you may have faced along the way.
Sure. So, you know, I read a statistic from the American Bar Association, which is kind of one of the, you know, associations focused on attorneys. And the statistics said that only 5% of lawyers were Black. And I think the number was 33% of lawyers were women, right? Mm-hmm. So I kind of fit in the intersection of, you know, one of that 5% and then one of the 33% of attorneys. And so I think that speaks volumes about the, you know, sort of place that I held at the big firm, of course, working in-house, meaning there weren't a lot of people who looked like me. I didn't see that as a hurdle per se. I saw it as an opportunity, if that makes sense to you. Mm-hmm. I think part of my perspective was, okay, this is what I've, these are the cards that I've been dealt. Let's see how I can make this work. And I found that I had a lot of mentors and sponsors mm-hmm. in that situation. I know that wasn't everyone's experience, but that was kind of, you know, if you think about an entrepreneur, you know, there are certain characteristics that we all have, right? And I think, you know, seeing opportunities where others don't is something that is consistent among entrepreneurs, especially successful entrepreneurs. And so that's kind of my perspective in general. In my field as a neutral, meaning a professional who helps others resolve conflicts. So as a mediator, as an arbitrator, as an ombudsman, just a person who is outside of the conflict that's coming in to help people negotiate and resolve the situation, there are even fewer women of color and Black women. And now we have an age component because I'm also probably on the younger side for some of the neutrals who are well known because many of them have very prestigious careers, either serving on the bench as judges or, you know, law firm partners, et cetera. And so they're amazing. They're top of their game, but that also means that they're going to be typically a lot older than me. Mm-hmm. And so the way that I've dealt with that hurdle is, you know, kind of continuing to be me and doing that by utilizing some of the things that we were talking about before, using social media, right? Mm-hmm. I have a very popular podcast as well called Breakthrough Barriers with Damali, where people call in with situations and I have guests come on and we talk about different ways that we would handle those situations. Mm-hmm. So kind of using my conflict resolution background to a real life scenario, just like the same thing you did when you're talking about the insurrection, a real life scenario. Mm-hmm. You know, I try to use my other platforms to help others, to empower people to resolve conflicts on their own. Mm-hmm. Whereas I think a lot of people in my profession typically kind of see themselves as the person to help resolve conflict, which I love being a problem solver. And, you know, you read my title, the one that I love, the chief conflict resolver. But I know that I can't be everywhere all the time to help people resolve their conflicts. Mm-hmm. So I want to build a community of worldwide conflict resolvers. I want people to learn these skills, the skills you were talking about at the beginning of the conversation, communication and de-escalation and other tools in our toolkit to help us navigate different scenarios. Mm-hmm. And so my mission is twofold. One is to empower people to become conflict resolvers so they can have more tools to resolve their own conflicts. And the second part of the mission is to be a trusted advisor for others who need help. So even if I train you, for example, to resolve your own conflicts, mm-hmm. there may be something that's like too serious or too personal or you're too close to you that, you know, you aren't able to put on your mediator hat, right? Mm-hmm. Because you're in it. But maybe now you are aware that there are other alternatives to resolving the conflict. You know, litigation is so popularized. People are always like, oh, I'm going to sue you. I'm going to take you to court. Well, guess what? Court has always been something that has taken a long time, has always been very expensive. And with COVID, a lot of courts have closed mm-hmm. and are still closed. Mm-hmm. They remain closed today. And so that means people have to utilize some of the other alternatives to resolving a dispute. Mm-hmm. And those things are mediation, it's arbitration, it's conciliation, it's other things that you have to do outside of the courtroom.
Yeah, no, absolutely.
That's important to me, though, people understanding those things and helping them to see options they never knew existed for resolution. Those things are very important to me, Keisha.
Yeah, no, that sounds amazing, Damali. And so how do you empower people to be conflict resolvers in their own life? I want to point to two kind of broad areas, because lots of young women come to me sometimes, you know, women of color, and they say, how do I negotiate at work for a higher salary? And how do I not let that escalate into, you know, not necessarily a conflict, but not escalate into tension there in that meeting? And then, of course, on the other hand, too, with just relationships in general, I know that's two different components, Damali. Like, do you have any tips or advice?
Certainly. So, you know, I'll start with the situation that happened yesterday where someone came to me because they had requested a certain salary and the counter offer they received from the employer was like 40% less, mm-hmm. right? You know, given the reality of what's happening in the world right now with, you know, the economy and, you know, struggling in some regards, the fact that we're still in a global pandemic, she wanted real advice as to like what she should do. And she came to me to say, you know, how should I negotiate this? And I'll tell you what I said to her. I gave her some options. Typically, I like to distill chaos from a variety of different thoughts that could be floating in someone's head to 3 or 4 points, right? Mm-hmm. To kind of give them something to sort of to focus on. So the first thing is you have the option to accept the offer, right? If you think that this is a fair offer, that it's taking into consideration your worth mm-hmm. and you think it's the right thing to do, then that's, of course, option number one. You can accept the offer. Option number two is you can push back with your original offer and provide some more information. Perhaps your value add proposition, you know, wasn't communicated clearly before, right? Mm-hmm. So there's a reason that you have the price that you have. And that's when I took the time to say, your price is your price. You value your services as is based on a variety of different things, including what the market will bear. And so everyone isn't going to be your customer when you're selling products, right? Mm-hmm. And everyone isn't going to be your employer if they don't have the budget to pay you what you're worth, because a few things could happen. One, you establish a precedent. If you accept a salary that's 40% less than what you're worth and you think that other employers will pay that, now you're kind of locked into that rate. And when you want to even negotiate or renegotiate with the current employer, you're going to be doing that based on the precedent that you've already established. You're never going to get to that other number if you start at 40% lower than where you were. You might go up, you know, maybe to the 50% level, mm-hmm. but you're never going to get to where you want to be. So you're kind of doing yourself a disservice by setting that precedent. Two, you may be resentful, right? Mm-hmm. If you take on the work and you're doing, and you know that the work is going to entail or require you to do more and you do it at a lower price, I don't know if you're going to give it your all, yeah. right? Yeah. If you don't feel like you're being fairly compensated. So anyway, that was the second option. And then the third option was to be creative, to think about where there was room to negotiate. Salary isn't always about a dollar amount. I think a lot of people get focused on the dollar amount and they don't think of creative out-of-the-box solutions as to how to make up for it in other areas. I've advised people who are negotiating on salary to think about, do you want more days off? Do you want to be off every other Friday? Do you want 6 weeks vacation instead of 4 weeks vacation? Mm-hmm. What other fringe benefits do you need? Would you like to get an MBA? Like, let's talk about some other things that can really make your compensation package more promising to you. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, I think where she landed was more in that third category of trying to think of different ways to get to the price that she wanted, especially given some of the things she wanted to do, that the company probably could meet her halfway on some of those other things. And I think that's where she ended up. And I also told her to take some time, mm-hmm. not to respond immediately, especially because time was not of the essence. And so for women in general, because that was what your question was, who are thinking about, you know, salary negotiations, one, know what you're worth, know what you demand in the market, do some research. Of course, COVID has really given us some interesting numbers to look at over the last almost year, but I still think that it depends on where you are in your life too, because if you don't have other options, meaning, you know, every other retailer in your industry has shut down, this is the only one, you know, then maybe you have to think about what that means and be creative about how to negotiate. But I have a problem with, you know, the failure to negotiate creatively.
And as you're talking about the whole compensation package, what came to me was the whole concept of holistic wealth as well, you know, because you're absolutely right. It's the total package and not necessarily just the money, but the other perks that enable you to achieve the goals that you want to achieve in your life and how you can get there through this method. So that's amazing advice. Damali, like, what inspires you in terms of your business? Is there any particular mentor or sponsor or something else that inspires you?
That's such a wonderful question, Keisha. You know, a lot of things inspire me. A lot of people inspire me. A lot of people have mentored me and continue to mentor and sponsor me throughout my career as I grow. If I have to look at it from the person who has inspired me the most for the longest period of time, of course, I'm going to say that's my mother. You know, she has always believed in me, told me I can do anything I wanted to do, be anyone or anything I wanted to be. And even as the world has grown and changed in different ways, like, of course, no one could have foreseen, you know, the advent of Google or social media or, you know, some of these other things that exist now in today's society that make it depends on what side of the table you sit on, but, you know, make it either easier or more complicated to kind of do some of the things that we're doing day society. But she is always motivating me and inspiring me. And what also inspires me in general are, mm-hmm. I think, like, children, right? The future, just thinking of things that we could all be doing because to mm-hmm. ensure that the future is better. So your books, your work with holistic wealth, thinking about ways to make people financially knowledgeable, to understand how they are viewing finances and things like that. And then also educating people so that they can educate themselves, educate others, and then think about different ways to build generational wealth. And so I think just seeing children inspires me to want, you know, to mm-hmm. think about things like climate change, think about, you know, conflict resolution, think about wealth building. Just think about the world and the future generations.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I definitely agree. And, you know, just in terms of kids, yeah, there's lots of inspiration there in terms of drawing on, just seeing their faces and knowing they're the next generation, their future is a lot in terms of what we can do and where the opportunities lie. So that's amazing. And so you mentioned generational wealth and the whole issue of financial wellness, which is great. Because as you know, like in my book, Holistic Wealth, I had stated that I think everyone needs to know their own personal financial identity. I think it's so important. And so readers from the book came back and they said, well, how do I recognize mine? How do I know what mine is? I don't know. And so I went back to the drawing board and I developed this framework. It was in the first lockdown, you know, when we were all at home, and I just drilled down in it and developed the framework and developed this quiz. And Damali, I know you took the quiz, and I've asked many guests on the show to just share with us the results and some thoughts on that, because it's part of my mission now to empower others based on my experience. And so if you could tell us what your results are and your thoughts on that, that would be amazing.
Certainly. So I took the test. I thought it was great. Just sort of the questions that I was being asked, because it made me pause to think about it a little bit. And as I was taking the test on the side, it had sort of, I think, four or five circles that were interlocking. So I had a sense that I was, you know, these are the categories, right? Mm-hmm. So I think one was risk taker, one was minimalist, et cetera. And so my results said that I was a minimalist. Mm-hmm. And I thought that was interesting. And I wanted to know more. Because I kind of feel like, you know how in astrology you can be like a Leo with like an Aquarius rising, right, or something? Like, I felt like, I mean, I am an entrepreneur. I have to be a risk taker by definition, mm-hmm. but I am a lawyer, which makes me risk averse. Mm-hmm. And so I like that I fell in the minimalist category, but I suspect that I had a risk taker rising. Like, I think that would have been the next one down, mm-hmm. Because I take calculated risks.
Yeah.
And so I thought that I love the quiz because I thought it was something that made me think. And then as I was answering the questions, I was like, who do I know that needs to take this quiz? Yeah. Like, what categories fall into?
Yeah, no, I think that's very interesting. And I like the fact that you've brought up that your legal background makes you risk averse, because that's like a new perspective that I've heard on it, which is amazing, which is why I love to hear people's thoughts on it. But definitely, I think that there may be some overlap for sure. As an entrepreneur, for sure, there's a level of risk taking. But I think it's just the dominant personality probably would fit into the minimalist category with like a subcategory of a risk taker, which would make total sense. I've interviewed other entrepreneurs, some of the most successful that I've interviewed are minimalists. It's so interesting to hear people's results. So you're in good company. And yes, and some others have spoken to the fact that they do think like a subcategory for them would be the risk taker category. Mm. But a lot of them have said to me that even in their own businesses, you know, in their branding philosophy and their spending, some of them who are minimalists, like you are, have stated that they're definitely conservative. And even in the way they go out there to attract business, their minimalist profile, you can see it there. And even one of them mentioned it's enmeshed in their branding philosophy. So that was amazing. It's just amazing to hear people's results and their thoughts. Because I think for others, it just gives so much more awareness out there about, you know, not only our tendencies, but in terms of how we harness the strengths of it. So thank you for that.
Sure. And one of the things I just wanted to say about the quiz, Keisha, especially on the page where you kind of give the intro for the quiz, one of the things that really resonated with me, and, you know, clearly this was, you wrote this and it was something that happened before I was scheduled to come on your mm-hmm. podcast. But one of the things that you said was, it was important for people to kind of know where they fell so that they could have a better understanding of certain things. And you said they can take advantage of the framework to help reduce conflict.
Yes.
Right? So of course that resonates with me, because it's almost, it's basically, it kind of parallels something that I do where I help people to understand their conflict profile. Mm-hmm. And so I felt like it was another way to help reduce conflict. It was giving people vocabulary. So maybe they, you know, realized they did certain things, but they didn't have like a go-to word for it.
Yes.
And so you give them kind of an archetype so they can, you know, they'll be a minimalist or a maximalist or the anxious spender investor or the risk taker. And then, you know, once you're in that framework, then you can kind of understand your habits, know what to work on, and then, you know, kind of have a sense of where you're going from there. So I thought it was a great framework from the perspective of a person who has spent a lot of time studying conflict resolution mm-hmm. to help minimize conflict. So I loved it for that reason too. I just thought it was great, very well done, super smart. And I hope everyone is reading your book, Holistic Wealth, 32 Life Lessons to Help You Find Your Purpose, Prosperity, and Happiness.
Oh, that's amazing, Damali. Thank you so much for that. Because when I kind of introduced it in the book, it was in the context of marriage. So it was in the context of a relationship and kind of negotiating, because that's what we all have to do, you know, within the context of a relationship, is that money negotiation with a significant other. And you're so right. When you have the vocabulary, and I actually think we should start thinking about this while we're dating, right? And before we have kids. Because when you don't have the vocabulary. It's hard to say why you're feeling so anxious sometimes when, for instance, a significant other has a different spending philosophy. So I'm so happy you brought that forward, because this is where it started for me. I recognized that my spouse at the time was a different financial identity. And at the time, I couldn't put my finger on it. I mean, he definitely was a minimalist, definitely. And of course, I think it's on a continuum too for each person. But like, I couldn't put my finger on a name. I didn't know what to call myself. And I just knew, though, that when I wrote the book, that we definitely needed to identify that. And so that's why I'm glad that we have this now, and that we're able to call names and identify and have the vocabulary, as you said. And you're right, a key thing within this framework is the negotiation, because now we have the words, and you're right, and avoiding conflict and having better outcomes. So thank you so much for raising that, because that was a key purpose for me driving this forward. And so, Damali, as we're wrapping up, I just want to know, what's on the horizon for Breakthrough ADR? What's coming up in the future? Can you share with us anything specific or exciting?
Yeah, of course. You know, I'm so excited. I am like just smiling from ear to ear, thinking about what's coming up for us. We've primarily been, you know, business to business, so B2B, working with organizations from training police officers at the New York Police Department to working with some pretty big organizations and their internal leadership, HR departments, and with staff, et cetera. And so now what we're trying to do is to open up some of our really popular services directly to consumers. And so later in this year, we're going to launch our training program, our courses online. There'll be asynchronous on-demand videos that people can purchase to learn these skills, which are essential skills. These are things that will help you regardless of your age, your background, your profession. These are things that will help with communication, which I read a quote from Warren Buffett from, I think, 2019, where he said the best investment that one could take is to invest in communication training, because that's something that's going to continue to help you and increase, I think it said something like productivity by 50%, especially for leaders. And so the trainings are being developed now. It's kind of hard to produce trainings in COVID times, but we're making it work. So I'm very excited about being able to offer some of the things that we've offered to directly to companies, to individuals who are interested in adding more tools to their toolkit for managing, preventing, and resolving conflict. So I'm really excited about that. We have a book that I'm working on that'll be hopefully published either by the end of this year, beginning of next year. And some initiatives that I'm trying to work on with, you know, I'm in New York, so working on with, you know, local government in New York to kind of focus on ways that we can empower more New Yorkers with some of these conflict resolution tools, especially as they're commuting, right? And so just thinking of different ways to utilize existing infrastructure to, again, continue to build this community of conflict resolvers. And what better place to do that than in New York, where, you know, we have 8.3 million people living in about 302 square meters, which makes it the most densely populated city in the U.S. and is also one of the top three visited cities in the world. So just thinking about making it sort of the model place for conflict resolution. So that's like my big, big lofty goal. But in the meantime, I'm going to keep helping people de-escalate conflict one person at a time.
I have goose pimples because I just like, oh, this is just wow. I mean, I am, you know, I'm cheering for you on the sidelines. And I hope that, you know, we can continue to follow along on, you know, all these initiatives. So do keep us in the loop. But it was so amazing having you on the show today, Damali. Can you tell us before you go where our audience can find you, like your website and social media?
Certainly. Thanks for asking, Keisha. My website is Breakthrough ADR. So Breakthrough, B-R-E-A-K-T-H-R-O-U-G-H. A is in Apple, D is in David, R is in Robert. .com. And on social media, we are basically at Breakthrough ADR everywhere, from YouTube, Instagram, LinkedIn, and Facebook. And then anyone can connect with me personally on LinkedIn at Damali Peterman.
Okay, amazing. And thank you so much for joining us today, Damali. This was an amazing session. Lots of wisdom and lessons learned here. So thank you so much.
You're welcome. Thanks for having me, Keisha.
thank you for joining us this week on Holistic Wealth with Keisha Blair. Make sure to visit our website, keishablair.com, where you can subscribe to the show on iTunes, Spotify, or via RSS so you will never miss a show. While you're at it, if you found value in this show, we'd appreciate a rating on iTunes, or if you simply tell a friend about the show, that would help us out too. Are you a member of the Institute on Holistic Wealth? If not, what are you waiting for? Go to InstituteOnHolisticWealth/memberships to choose your membership plan and join. As a member, you get so many perks. Free worksheets, advice, coaching, and a member's workshop to design an intentionally designed life. You need to figure out your life purpose? Take the Build Your Life Purpose Portfolio online self-paced course. You're struggling with all your money decisions? Take the free financial identities quiz and then take the course. You recently had a breakup, job loss, or experienced the death of a loved one? Take the holistic healing course. You need an overall plan to achieve holistic wealth? We will help you figure out your holistic wealth blueprint. And of course, if you want to start making money by helping others achieve holistic wealth, become a certified holistic wealth consultant. Regardless of what career you've got, the Institute will show you how to increase your income and walk in your purpose. The sooner you join, the sooner you start to achieve a more holistically wealthy lifestyle. And you're going to want to stay for a very long time. So go to InstituteOnHolisticWealth/memberships to join. If you haven't read the book yet, pick up a copy of the award-winning best-selling Holistic Wealth, 32 life lessons to help you find purpose, prosperity, and happiness.